So next presenter might have an idea. He is the tech lead on the blockchain team in National Bank of Greece. Please give a warm welcome to Mr. Nikolas Dervenis. Best suit of the day so far.
Working in a bank may seem like working in a big tech company, and that's why that happens, because banks are going digital. And they're going digital because they are following the technology. And to do so, we as engineers need to think outside the box, as you see there. But do you as individuals think outside the box? And that's why I brought you this riddle. How many do you know this riddle? Raise your hand. Okay. How many of you know the solution of the riddle? Okay. Please do not share the solution with your friends nearby, okay? Otherwise, we will ruin the whole game. So, do you have pen and paper ready? The goal here is to connect the dots using four straight lines. But by the time you start, you cannot take the pen off the paper. Okay, that's the trick. So, an example is this, a failed attempt. I'll give you 1 minute. Okay, try to solve it. Are you ready? Raise your hand if you are ready. Raise your hand. How many are ready?
How many lines?
How many? Four. Four lines. Ready. Get ready, please. I want you to participate. Okay. And the time starts. How do I play this? Oh, the time has started. Go. I'm coming down. Where are we? Here we are. Okay, last 10 seconds. Okay, finish. How many did you solve it? 1, 2, 3. Okay, does your solution seem like this one?
Yes.
You see, by the time you take the line outside the imaginary box, you start thinking outside the box. And that's why I showed you this riddle. But what if I tell you that you can use one straight line and connect all the dots? Can you imagine such a solution? Okay, here it is. You see, this may seem a little bit odd, but it's a very legit solution. And the reason I'm showing this to you is because thinking outside the box is never enough. And now, back to the talk. Who are we? We are National Bank of Greece. And you see, National Bank of Greece is the oldest and the first bank of the country. It has been in operations almost since the foundation of the Greek state, being the oldest company of the country. But as I told you, and as you probably know, banks are going digital. And they are going digital in every direction, from their core procedures to its retail products, everywhere. So we are trying to evolve with the technology and follow the technological evolution. And technology is moving fast, and it's moving like this. Here you see Las Vegas, back in 1965, and 2 years ago in 2016. By looking at these two pictures, a nice analogy seems to emerge. You know, technology yesterday was much more isolated, based mainly in independent systems, while the human factor was much more dominant. Today, as we know, technology is very different. The technology is much more complex, it's much more connected, while we as humans are getting less and less involved. So what will be the technology of tomorrow, nobody knows, but we can make assumptions and we can see the trend. And with these assumptions, we are taking action today. So we formed the Digital Transformation Division, a unit formed 2 years ago to promote the simplification and the optimization of processes and to help adopt a new mindset about technology use and about technology in general. They think we look like this, okay? People think that we are a strict corporate organization as a bank, which we are in many cases, okay? But not everywhere, and for sure not in our department. We are looking more like this, you see? We are a division in which we are implementing and transforming the bank digitally using open APIs and big data. We are experimenting with new technologies like machine learning and blockchain. We are forming study groups, and in general, we maintain a really open mindset. We believe in the power of communities, and we try our best to create one. That's why we created the NBT Technology Hub, to get close with developers from all over the country and beyond. A community that may lead to a potential cooperation or just an exchange of passion and information. But now that you know who we are, let's talk about some of the most interesting technologies we are using. First of all, the open banking. We have introduced our open banking platform in which we are exposing our APIs that allow third parties and customers to connect directly to our systems. Open banking, as you see, that's what the word says, opens the bank's systems and data to its customers and developers, and enables the creation of independent applications that connect directly with the bank systems, without the need for the bank to intercept. We saw open banking not just as a compliance checkbox that we should tick off, but we saw it as a way to open a collaboration space with other technological organizations. And that's why we are holding a competitive position on a global scale. But we are expecting, in the years to come, the transaction through our APIs to get large in a very large scale, because they will handle maybe most of our banking procedures. So we believe that the need for tracing data flows and transactions in the future will get bigger and bigger. So we need registering services, registry mechanisms in order to store and monitor transactions, both for us and our customers. We have registering mechanisms using traditional technologies, but we designed something new in order to meet the future requirements. Such a registry service will have the following characteristics. Remember, registry service for storing transactions and data flows. It will be flexible, which means that the customer will decide if they will need and if they will want to use the service. It will be immutable, which means that no one will be able to change what has been written. It will be verifiable, which means that anyone can validate the transactions, and they do not need to trust the bank. It will be reusable, which means that it can be used from other organizations and corporations for their own purposes. It will be open and public, which means that anyone can read the registry service. And it will be customizable. This, which means that the customers will select which part of their data they will store and under which policies this data will be retrieved. We believe that these are the requirements for a registering service of the future. And to build it, we ended up using a blockchain. And for those of you that do not know what the blockchain is, it's an immutable, decentralized, open ledger. Quickly, what is it's a ledger because it's something that stores transactions. It's open because anyone can read what is inside. It's decentralized, which means that there's not one ledger that somebody holds. On the contrary, every node of the network maintains their own independent copy of the ledger. And it's immutable because no one can change the records of the ledger. That's a blockchain. So to demonstrate how this works, whenever somebody uses our APIs, if they want, they can store their transaction directly on a blockchain. And now anyone can serve as verifier and communicate directly with the blockchain to verify if some transaction exists. So clients and other third parties have the option to securely store their data on the blockchain when anyone can serve as verifier. As you see here, we are using blockchain technology to solve a very niche problem. And that's what we are missing about blockchain in general. We are expecting too much. And that's why, at the end of the day, we do not see real-life applications with blockchain. As I've said before, another title for blockchain, other than immutable decentralized open ledger, can be blockchain. Many are discussing, few are implementing. Because you do not see real-life applications usually. We need to approach blockchain as a tool and use it when and where it solves us problems. And I think that's exactly what we did here. So back to the project, we started with an idea, obviously, and we quickly moved to phase one, when we had internal cycles trying to create an MVP, a minimum viable product, using mostly open source software. And now we are in phase two, where we are working on a production-ready solution using two of the most acceptable blockchain technologies out there, the Ethereum network as an open source approach, and the Hyperledger as an enterprise solution. And now, let's dive into some of the challenges we faced and discuss the technology in some more detail. Challenge one. One does not simply add banking data to a blockchain, of course not. It's personal private banking data. You cannot take them and put them on a blockchain. They will shut us down the other day. So to solve this issue, we are using cryptography. In a simplified version, what we are doing is we take our data, we parse them into a cryptographic mechanism in order to transform them into a hash. For those of you that do not know what a hash is, it's a string of numbers and characters, which is impossible to reverse engineer. In other words, given different inputs, you guaranteed to get different hashes, but knowing the hash, you can never go back to the data. It's working like the human fingerprint. I guess you get the point. So, challenge two. It's easy to encrypt our data, but how do you encrypt the data? Okay, back to the architecture diagram, what we did. Every time that somebody wants to store their transactions, as we said, they transform them into a fingerprint and then on the blockchain. But at the same time, both the fingerprint and the actual data will go to an off-chain database, which database will then be used by a data retrieval platform. So this time we know which fingerprint matches with which data. To visualize how this works, let's say that you are a customer and you went to the blockchain and found a fingerprint you want to validate. Let's take the first scenario where you have the actual data of the transaction you are searching for because maybe you were part of the transaction and you have stored it in your own database. In this case, you take the data, you transform them, you get a new fingerprint, and then you check the fingerprints. So if they are a match, you are sure that this transaction exists. If you do not have the data, you can head over to the data retrieval platform, and if you are authorized to do so, the platform will give you the data, and then you follow the same procedure. You transfer it, you get a new fingerprint, and then you check the fingerprints. Okay, challenge three. As we said, it's customer's choice which data will be stored and under which policies this data will be retrieved. For this issue, we are using smart contracts deployed on the blockchain, which the smart contract set the policies of storing and retrieval of the data. And the platform offers some basic smart contracts, but anyone who wants can write them their own smart contracts and deploy them on the blockchain to use them for their own transaction. Now that I guess, because I guess most of you are technical people, I have brought you a little bit about the architecture of our system, just to know. This is our proof of the proof of concept Ethereum network. The network is maintained by three sealers which are authorized to write on blockchain and one single node that just listens to the blockchain and sends transactions. We have a registry service that communicates with the blockchain, an off-chain database, and our APIs. Now every customer or third party can use the service from our APIs or the registry service. And anyone can serve us, verify it, communicating directly with the blockchain and the registry service. The important thing here is that anyone can maintain their own nodes without the need for communicating with our own nodes. And that's what's exciting about blockchain. They don't need to communicate with our own nodes inside the bank. They can use their own nodes. But enough with blockchain and enough with registering. Registering data is important, very important, but maybe most important is how you use your data, because there are a lot of them. So we have introduced our big data infrastructure, a service, a platform responsible for collecting data from our users and services, from the whole spectrum of the services we offer. We collect data whenever our customers step into our local branches and interact with our employees, whenever they use our internet and mobile apps, whenever they call out our contact center, whenever they use our ATMs, APIs, and in general we collect a lot of data and put them in a big data lake. This big data lake will then be used to feed machine learning and AI algorithms and data analytics in order to analyze our customers' behavior and predict their needs, and then adjust our applications and our services accordingly. Nice, part three. How are we working? Okay, I told you who we are and which technology we're using, but how are we working? As a big organization, we are using mostly waterfall software development model. Waterfall is a sequential flow of processes in which organization begin with the requirements, then the design, then the implementation, then the verification, and lastly, the maintenance of the product. It's called waterfall because it is a sequential flow of processes, but this guy there is screaming for Agile. And screaming for Agile, not because maybe most of the biggest software companies right now use it, but it's screaming for Agile because it has been proven that Agile brings results. In Agile, the requirements and the solutions emerge through the collaborative working of self-organized and cross-functional teams and their end users and then customers. For those of you that want to learn more about Agile, you can head over to agilemanifesto.org and learn everything and the principles behind Agile. Because I decided to talk about how we are using Agile, I think it would be more interesting. And we are using Scrum. Scrum is a subset of Agile, and I will go through the basics of Scrum and how it can be used to a big organization. First of all, when using Scrum, you have the Scrum team. The Scrum team consists of the product owner, which is there to carry the vision of the product, talk with executives, and in general maintains the business side of the product. You have the Scrum Master, which is there to make sure that the team have everything they need in order to perform at their higher level. And then you have the Dev team, which is the actual team of developers that build the product. They communicate with each other daily through the daily Scrum meeting, and they are close to each other. So let's say that you want to build the new product using Scrum. The team will break the product into features called user stories. And we call them user stories because they are written from the perspective of the customer.
Okay. Hi.
User stories because they are written from the perspective of the customer. Perform as a role, I want feature so that benefit. For example, as an API consumer, I want to store my transaction on the blockchain so that I can prove their existence. That's a user story, a broad user story, but you get the point. After the team breaks the product into user stories, they create the product backlog. The product backlog contains all the features of the product. Then the team selects user stories in order to create a release, and then creates a release backlog. The team then prioritizes the user stories, and they make a rough estimation about how many work hours they will need in order to complete these features. If one feature is expected to take too long, they break it down to smaller user features, and so on. Yes. Then they remake the release backlog, and when it's ready, the team splits the release backlog into sprints. Sprints is where the work is being done, the actual work. A sprint lasts between 1 to 4 weeks, and at the end of each sprint, the features are production ready. At the end of each sprint also, the team makes the sprint retrospective meeting in order to communicate and discuss what went wrong, what went well, what improved, and so on. To monitor the project, a Scrum team uses this one, the burnout chart, which is maybe the number one reason for Scrum to be so popular, because it can give you a really good picture how the project is going, and it contains a lot of information in a very simplified form. For example, the burnout velocity. The burnout velocity shows the pace of the team, and by using this tool, the team can know if they are too quick or too slow, so adjust accordingly, and a lot of other information that I cannot describe right now. wrapping up. So, I told you who we are. I told you what technology we're using. I told you how we're changing the way we work. And now, I will give you another riddle for homework. Write it down. This is one of my own riddles. So, I expect your answers on my LinkedIn or find us outside to discuss. Integral equals triangle equals alerting. You need to think outside the box. Okay, what am I? That's the riddle. And thank you very much. Have a hidden scene. If you want to find us and code with us, head over to developer.mg.gr. And if you want to find which problems are facing and drive yourself, go to race.mg.gr. Thank you.